Morning, everyone. Morning. Welcome to Hamilton Old Parish Church's service this morning. Great to see you all as always, and also it's super to see quite a few visitors that we've got with us this morning. I'm delighted to tell you that coffee resumes after the service this morning, so if you're a visitor, come across and join us for a cup of coffee and a chat. If you're watching this by live streaming, or by any other means, if you're watching a recording of the service later, it's also super to have you with us, and we hope that sometime you'll be able to come back to church and join in with our worship. But in the meantime, we do hope that you find our worship meaningful and uplifting. The intimations are as per your order of service. As this is the end of the summer holidays for the children, it's an all-age service this morning. And the creches, although the creche is available for parents if they'd like to use it, so it is a children's service, but if you feel you want to take your kids across to the creche, then feel free to do that. There is no Sunday Live, and that will start back next week when normal service at Sunday Live and normal service here will be resumed. Next week there will also be a Sunday Live Big Breakfast, which is a family service starting at 9:30 a.m. However, today, as I said, we're all together and we celebrate our children's return to school, as well as the resumption of some of our usual church activities. So with that in mind, and I've told you about the tea and coffee, that's everything as far as the intimations are concerned. All I have to do, sadly, is to remind you again of the funeral of Georgiane Moffat, known as Jan Moffat, will be held tomorrow at 12:30 p.m. in South Lanarkshire Crematorium. Those are all the intimations. Thank you.
Everybody. Very warm welcome, one and all. I know Louise already made various welcomes to you this morning, especially those visiting with us. It's lovely to see you this morning and to be able to worship together. We have a back-to-school service today, so as has already been mentioned, the children are in with us for the whole of the service this morning as we think about their both return to school and also our return to the various things that the church does throughout the year now that we've really started to convene after the summer holidays. And I hope, particularly over the next couple of weeks, perhaps the last few folks who've been away on the summer holiday will be back with us again also. But we're called to worship, and we're called to worship this morning with some further words from the Psalms, this time Psalms 80. And there the psalmist invites God to listen to his prayer and to listen to our prayer. He repeats a number of times his request that he be helped to repent or to turn around from perhaps the position he was in or the situation he was in and to face God himself. There in Psalm 80, just the last verse, for example, says, "Turn us again, O Lord of hosts, cause thy face to shine, and we shall be saved." What a glorious hope we have, and what glorious sentiments we find there. Let's give thanks. Let's stand, if we're able, and sing hymn 180, "Give Thanks." Letter of Peter, we're reminded of God's words, which are taken from the Torah, from God's law, those first few books of the Bible. And there he reminds us, it is written, "You must be holy because I am holy." This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated as we prepare our hearts for prayer. Let us pray. Lord, you are a holy God, and you expect us to be holy. You are a God who is love, and you expect us to be loving. We've come to hear again the story of your love for us and for all the world. We come to celebrate that in the face of your Son, we have seen your love. Thank you that on the cross he demonstrated once and for all your grace, which is at the heart of all creation. And by that same grace, search our hearts, renew our lives, and transform our worship, not just here in this place, but every hour of every day, O of lives dedicated to you. We pray for your Holy Spirit, believing you have sent him with a message of life and of hope, of challenge and change, a message of Christ. May the power of the Spirit apply your word to our life together here and our lives for you in the week to come. Draw us closer to each other as families and as the family of God, as we pray together using the words that Jesus taught us as a family to say, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, I wonder if some of the young ones might like to join me at the front just for a few moments. If you'd like to do that. Further up if you want. Don't worry about the bags. If you can sit on the front of the seat, that'd be great. Lovely. We'll get to them in a minute. That's all right, George. Don't worry about that. Okay. Thank you, George. Right. Can I ask you, first things first, who's back to school already? Oh, teachers as well. Yes, some of the teachers as well. And who's yet to go back this week? And who's got a little bit longer? Are you glad you've got a little bit longer? Brilliant. Can I tell you, I'm really glad that schools have gone back in. But not for the reason you might think. It's because I get to see all you guys again. You know, when everybody's away on holiday, there's very few children here because families go away on holiday during the school holidays, don't they? It makes sense. Families have to. They've got to go when the school holidays are on. But I'm really glad to see so many of you back again. Can I really honestly tell you, it does my heart good. It really does my heart good to see all of you here. So I'm really delighted that you're back here, even if it is just because you're back to school. So have you all got, for those who've gone back to school, was the school still there when you went back? Really? Really? Yeah. Oh, were your teachers there?
Yeah.
Really? You're serious? She was there 2 days before you? Were you the same then? I have to say, I really feel quite sorry for our teachers having to go back early.
She had to come back 2 days early.
She had to come back 2 days early. That's pretty rotten, isn't it? But that's the way work works sometimes. Yes, double word. So your classroom was there? You had a classroom all ready for you? New classrooms?
Yeah.
Yeah, new teachers? New people in your class? Was it exactly the same as last year? You had some new people there as well?
Yeah.
You had exactly the same people, Rebecca? Okay. But some changes there in what you've got. And can I tell you as well, there'll be something about your school this year, for those who've just started, you've only had 2 days, those who are starting this week, and those who've yet to go back yet towards the end of your summer holidays. There are all sorts of changes you're going to face, let's be honest. You're into the next year of school. It's going to be a little bit harder. Is that good or is that bad? Good. So you're liking the challenge? Excellent. Good. So it is good. We get challenged. We get stretched as well. I've also been reminded that as well as us now getting into that second half of the year, the summer holidays are behind most of us, that, well, what else have we got to look forward to this year? Andrea? There's always one, isn't there? They won't let it lie. Christmas. 18 and a half weeks to go, okay? It's Plenty of time, yeah. I know some of the, Douglas was telling me, some of the Christmas cards are already out in the shops. They've changed what's in the shops, and we're now getting Christmas cards in the shops again. 18 and a half weeks to go. If you need to start saving, now's a good time. But for all that, yeah, we've got a long way to Christmas yet, but we'll enjoy it very much when it comes. We have a service today where we're going to be talking mostly about things to do with faith and believing in God. And one thing that's really key in our faith is actually how we pray to the God that we believe in. Now, we've just finished our prayers this morning as I was up in the pulpit and you were all down here. We finished them as we always do with the Lord's Prayer, didn't we? So be so familiar with the Lord's Prayer. I know it's slightly different versions of it, particularly towards the end. But so familiar to it. We're so familiar with it that we recite that quite happily, don't we? For the balance of this year, towards this end of year, on the way up to Christmas, there's that dirty word again, on the way up to Christmas, I'm hoping we're going to talk a little bit more about prayer, but particularly about the Lord's Prayer. For those who've had the order of service and looked at it already, you'll probably see that I do want to concentrate on just one facet of the Lord's Prayer today. We're going to go through it, particularly as we're all here as a church family together, not every week, but every other or every third or fourth week, looking at a different facet of the Lord's Prayer so we know what we're praying about. How does the Lord's Prayer start? Who can tell me that? Oh, a few hands up here. Let's give it visitors first, shall we? Excellent. So we just start with the first bit then. Our Father in Heaven. So we just start with that. What does that mean? Have you thought about that before? Person who made you is up in heaven. That's a really good answer. Thank you. The person who made us is up in heaven. Does it tell us anything else? What was it? It might be different things to each of us, yeah? As we pray, there were different things in our minds. Did you have a point there, Gregory, or just, was your hand just going up? Are you thinking of something? No, it's gone. That's okay. But you can. You're just scratching your head thinking about it. That's all right. What about anybody else? Because this isn't just about the children. This is a family service, and we are church family together. When we pray, Our Father in Heaven, what does that mean to us? What do we mean by that? Any takers?
It's his address.
It's his address. Ah, very good. So it's like a postcode. Our Father in Heaven. So we know where the prayer's going. Thank you, Sandy. Anybody else? Like I say, it can mean different things to different people.
I can have a relationship with him like my dad.
You can have a relationship with him like your dad. Fantastic. And your dad's not a bad old sport. So, yeah, we can have a relationship with him like our own physical fathers. These are all really key points. Really key points. And you've covered most really of what I wanted to say, except for one point. And that one point is in the very first word. Let's see if anybody else wants it first. It's yours. It's everybody's Father, not just ours. He is ours. He is personally ours. We can't own him, but he is everybody. Ours is plural, isn't it? All of us. And so when we pray that as a church family, there is something we are doing together that is about owning our God together as well as individually. We're a family. We're part of the family of God. And when we pray that week by week by week, we're reminded of that, even in those simple first few words of Our Father in Heaven. And so the prayer goes on. As I say, for the balance of this year, we're going to look more at that. We're going to look at different parts of that prayer and just try to unpack them together. And just like today, I might be asking you questions. So have a wee think about that as we go through the Lord's Prayer week by week. You're going to get a week off next week, but we will come back to the next part of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in Heaven, hallowed be thy name, will be the next bit we'll look at. So thank you for that. I'm going to let you go back just now. So thank you for coming out for me. You'll have a chance to come out a little bit later again as the service unfolds. So thank you for that. I thought it might be quite nice, actually, because we are thinking about aspects of faith. We are a long way from Christmas, but it's nice to have a reminder of Christmas, even at this stage in life. We're going to turn to the back of our order of service, and we're going to sing a hymn that's perhaps also known as a Christmas carol. The Virgin Mary had a baby boy. We are thinking about our Father in heaven, but we're also thinking about the Son who came to earth as a baby boy. The Virgin Mary had a baby boy.
Hear the word of God as it is recorded in Hebrews, reading from chapter 11, verse 29 to chapter 12, verse 2, taken from the New International Version. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry land, but when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after the army had marched around them for 7 days. By faith, the prostitute Rahab, because she welcomed the spies, was not killed with those who were disobedient. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, about David and Samuel, and the prophets who, through faith, conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised. Who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. There were others who were tortured, refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Amen.
We are never alone. Never, ever alone. Maybe that's been re-emphasized to us in our prayer, Our Father. But the writer to the letter of the Hebrews gives us so many examples of faithful people. Those who are our forebears, effectively, in faith, and who have gone before us. But I want to ask you a question. What came first, the chicken or the egg?
The egg.
The circle had no beginning. Oh, we're getting philosophical. That's in primary school. Just wait till you get philosophy 101 in university. You're in for a bad time of it, Dale. What came first, the chicken or the egg? It's a trick question. The answer is God. It's an article of faith that God comes before everything else. If God made everything, including chickens and eggs, regardless of which physically came first, it stands to reason that he came first. That's our belief, and perhaps something that we have faith in. I make that suggestion, I'd like to discuss this just briefly, because there are so many occasions in life where our faith is tested, just as the people we hear about in that passage we heard read in Hebrews. And all those stories that perhaps we're familiar with, some more familiar with, some less familiar with. It's usually that our faith is perhaps tested as a consequence of the actions of other human beings, other people. Or maybe something to do with our health. Or something that outrages us in our environment around and about us. But tested it is. I probably suspect there are very few of us who have managed to get through life without having our faith tested in one way or another, and maybe in some of those areas I've talked about. What is faith all about? What's it all about? Well, how does faith work on a human level, first of all? You believe that someone exists. You probably tangibly can actually speak to them and see them. You believe, perhaps, in their ability to help. Do you believe in them? Do you trust them? Perhaps that's the case. And in fairness, sometimes that trust can be misplaced. And a particular area for concern, especially these days perhaps, is in politics. But generally speaking, the majority of people will help if they can. Have you found that to be the case? The majority of people, if they can, will help out. And sometimes the most surprising people. You know, the neighbor you've never spoken to before, three doors up, who lends a hand because your car's broken down or something else perhaps of that nature. Does it work the same way with God? Does it work the same way with our faith in God? We believe he exists. We believe he has the ability to help. We believe in him. We trust him. But in many ways, that's the middle bit. That's the middle bit. God gives us cause to believe and trust in him, either through personal experience or by reflecting on the experiences of others, especially as we read through the experiences we find in the stories of Scripture. Just as our belief and our trust in an individual, even one who we've never actually met, be it maybe a scientist, or perhaps it may be more rarely a politician, something that we experience about them, either directly or through others, causes us to place some kind of trust in them or what it is that they might have to say. And having come to believe and trust in someone often leads to some kind of action on our part. Either we speak up for them, or we work for their aims as though they were our own. Perhaps they're aligned with our own, and that's why we trust them in the first place. We do something that's in similarity and in accordance with that. Or perhaps we hope for some kind of assistance from them. And maybe they've proven themselves trustworthy in the past. And so we anticipate, hopefully, that they'll also reciprocate that way again another time. We don't do that with someone in whom we have no trust or belief, neither on a human level or on a godly one. And in the case of God, that can cause us to go to some extraordinary lengths to learn about God personally and then collectively also together, or to be a better person with all the slips and trips that come along the way, or to invest our time and our effort in his church. You believe in God? James tells us, you believe in God, you do well. The demons believe and they shudder. You have faith in someone? You have faith in God. But what does that lead you to do? And that's the crux of James's argument, actually. What does that lead you to do? Does it lead you to learn more about him? Perhaps through our church attendance, be it in person or online or through a recording. You're doing that now. To try to be more Christ-like in our speech and in our actions. To complete, perhaps, works that show our faith in the world at large and perhaps through his church. The action is not the faith, but it perhaps shows that we have faith. The action is not the faith itself, but it perhaps shows that we have faith. What comes first, the chicken or the egg? You should have that one by now. God? What comes first, faith or works? Same answer. God. The God who gives us cause to have faith, the God who gives us that faith. Then comes the faith. Then comes the works. We might question our faith from time to time, with all that life throws at us, all the vagaries in life. But we shouldn't really question our works of faith performed in good faith. They are all a gift of God. We have so many examples from Scripture that show that we are in good company with those of faith in the past, those of faith in the present, and even those yet to come, those who will have faith in the future. And with that in mind, can we sing the next hymn together? Hymn 517, Fight the Good Fight.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord, on this journey of life, this journey of faith, we find ourselves journeying in ups and in downs and through all sorts of various changes. Change can be painful to us. We like what is familiar, and yet life doesn't just give us the familiar. And so often it's like shifting sands beneath our feet. We have children who are starting school and new classes. We have teachers in their preparation and parents in their separation, perhaps from their children or grandchildren, and returning to a regular routine. We pray for each in turn. There are those who are starting a new job or a placement, and those facing changed circumstances of health or of family or friendships. Help us to grow and to learn, even in the midst of change and even in the midst of the tests to our faith. Help us to support each other as the family of faith, to encourage each other as a Christian family together, taking our baptism vows seriously as we care for the vulnerable in our congregation. Lord, there are times that we do not realize that there are those of us who are vulnerable. So help us to treat one another kindly, as if we were Christ himself, caring for Christ himself. And help us to look for justice in the world for those who need assistance. For in this changing world that tries our faith on so many occasions, we need assistance. We look not just to ourselves. There are those others who need assistance. Our Father in heaven, hear our prayer. For those things we cannot effect ourselves, help us to trust in you, that thy will be done in this world and in the next. Amen. Shall we sing our next hymn? Hymn 259, Beauty for Brokenness.
Thank you.
Our New Testament lesson this morning is taken from Luke's Gospel, reading chapter 12, verses 49 to 56, again from the New International Version. I have come to bring fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. But I have a baptism to undergo, and what constraint I am under until it is completed. Do you think I came to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but division. From now on, there will be five in one family, divided against each other. Three against two, and two against three. They will be divided, father against son, and son against father, mother against daughter, and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. He said to the crowd, when you see a cloud rising in the west, immediately you say, it's going to rain, and it does. And when the south wind blows, you say, it's going to be hot, and it is. Hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of the earth and the sky. How is it that you don't know how to interpret this present time? Amen. May God bless to us these readings from his holy word.
I wonder again if the children might like to join me at the front. And again, this is for everybody. But what do we have here? What do you think, Rebecca? An eraser. Does it look like a eraser to you? A bit big, isn't it?
Yeah.
Is it rubbing out something really, really big, do you think?
Yeah.
It really follows on from our last few years of Back to School Sundays. We're building up our church pencil case. I don't know if you've noticed this, because 2 years ago we had our giant pencil that we had, didn't we? You might recall that we talked about that in terms of us making our mark, perhaps thinking about the marks that show we're Christians, things like that. We make marks with a pencil. So we looked at that a couple of years ago at Back to School Sunday. We also last year looked at this one. What we got here?
A giant ruler.
Giant ruler. Actually, Kyle, do you mind standing up just a second? Oh, you know, last year I think you could barely reach the top of that. Look at you now! Look at you now! I'll do that with everybody. Who else would do it? And you two weren't even around. You weren't. It's lovely to see you. It was lovely to have you here and get baptised here as well. And you're much bigger as well, Greg. I think that was up to your shoulders last time, wasn't it? You're both getting so big. We all measure ourselves to see how big we're getting, perhaps. And for some of us, it's not just top of the way. Sometimes it's just round. But yeah, we measure ourselves and see what we measure up to, don't we? I don't know if you remember last year, this is really thinking back now, but last year we looked at the only rule by which we should lead our lives, and we pointed that out as being Scripture, is the only rule to help us direct and to rule our lives. And so we're reminded with our ruler that Scripture has a huge impact and a huge input into our lives, and particularly our lives of faith. So what has a rubber or an erasure got to do with our faith and with what we're doing? What do you think, Thomas? Say again? Rubbing out something you've done wrong. That is excellent. That's what you use a rubber for, isn't it? Good answer. Excellent. I'm going to hide behind here again quickly. Not because I'm scared of you, but because I've rewritten this sermon three times. I don't want to get lost in my notes. I have rewritten this three times, and I will probably get lost in my notes. Life is really good. It really is, to be honest with you. It's full of good things. It's full of beauty. Especially in the summer, we see beautiful things. We see it from spring forwards. Maybe you're looking forward to autumn. Are you an autumn person? Some people love to see the changing colours of the leaves. With your colour of hair, I'm not surprised. Changing colour of the leaves, and the leaves falling, and the snow, and of course, when we get it, and that maybe heralds Christmas. Couldn't resist throw that in there. Maybe we get snow after Christmas, I don't know. Maybe it's our Christmas present. Life's full of beauty. It's full of friendships. It's full of laughter and fun. There are so many good things about life. But it's also, contained within it, has its own fair share of division, anger, and mistakes, and other things besides. It seems, that just seems to be the nature of life. Jesus even suggested that with regards to his teaching. Beautiful as it might be, full of forgiveness as it might be, Jesus' own teaching would be a cause of division, even in families. As some accepted and some rejected, sometimes vehemently, the message that he had to bring. Very often because it brought change. It brought change to attitudes, perhaps a change to practices. We talked a little earlier about the works that follow our faith. We change. We can't help but change as we learn more about God and about his love for us and what Christ's done for us. That inevitably causes a change. We change. We change in life anyway, but we especially change as we try to become more like Christ. So that in itself can sometimes be a cause of division, even in the closest of families. And that which Jesus provided, that perhaps causes that change, was given at great cost. At the cost of his own life, Jesus dealt with our mistakes, all of them. How do you fix mistakes in your homework?
Rubber.
Yeah, if you got a mistake in your homework, do you try and rub it out?
But not if it's pen.
There's always one.
Scrap one. Have a copy of it without that mistake.
So you then got to make a copy of you without the mistake.
The mistake and just rip out the page.
And rip out the page? Do you not think that's a little bit drastic? You could scribble on it and mark it out, blot it out by scribbling on it. Or you could get an ink rubber. You can actually get ink rubbers. We've not showed you them yet, have we? You get them in high school when you get to use pens. It's okay. But usually it's a rubber, isn't it? Particularly for doing things in pencil. So we'll stick with that analogy for the minute, and I'll have a think about some of the other ones later when I'm not so challenged. Perhaps you use an eraser. But where do you get an eraser to fix the mistakes of life? You can't just tear the page out and throw it away. You can make more of a mess of it. And maybe we've been inclined to do that ourselves in the past. It happens. Where do you get an eraser to rub out the mistakes in life, to fix those mistakes? Mistakes that perhaps ultimately disfigure and graffiti the image of God that God has placed in each of us. Have you thought about that recently? As a child of God, in the image of God, when we make mistakes, it's like we're graffitiing on the image of God. How do we fix that? How do we rub out that mistake? Where do you get an eraser that will help you to do that? To erase the mistake between yourself and God in whose image you are. You know the secret? You don't ask the minister for his giant eraser. You ask Jesus, and he'll let you use his. You ask Jesus, and he will let you use his. It ultimately comes down to an eraser. Jesus erases our mistakes, the mistakes between us and God, if we can only believe and trust in him to do so. Now, for some, that's foolishness. But to the children of God, it's the blessing of God. Amen. We can't do that alone, but God, especially through the Holy Spirit, can help us. So let's pray for God's assistance and work with our prayers. Let us pray. Almighty God, you know us better than ourselves, and you know what we personally are going through as individuals, and also even as a church. What changes we face, from the youngest to the oldest, the school child, the working age adult, the retired, and everything in between. Are we proving faithful to you individually and as a congregation? Help us, Lord. We have faith. Help us in our unbelief. Blot out and erase our mistakes. Send down your Holy Spirit that we might taste and see that you are good, and that we might experience seasons of refreshment that make us grow into the kind of Christians that you want us to be, caring for each other and those around us, and loving you, our God, with our whole heart and mind and soul and strength. Glory be to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as it is in the beginning, is now, and forevermore will be. Amen. Our offerings will now be brought forward, and actually, maybe one or two of the children might like to help today. Would that be okay? Because I've just picked four of you. Kyle, would you help? Stuart? Certainly, young man. Please do. Do you want to help in that time? Sit there with Andrew. Gregory, can you go back, sit back down and choose different ones? And Amelia, please. So, will you help Kyle then? Thank you. We've brought forward our offerings. Let's dedicate them to God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you our offerings. We give you our strength, even as we receive from you our strength and all that is in our hands. We dedicate these things to your glory. May you empower us to do all that you require of us, that your kingdom might come. Amen. So it's been lovely to have the children with us for the whole of this service. Back to usual service next week with the Sunday Live as well. I hope that families will join us for the family service earlier on at 9:30. And I hope that those who are going back to school this week and a little bit further in the future enjoy going back to school as well. I'm delighted that the halls are back in use so we can have teas and coffee. I do hope you'll make use of them. I will pre-warn you that the heating has, although there's a handover on the new heating in the halls on Tuesday, I understand, that it's very warm in there. Very warm in there, and a little bit quieter than the old heaters. So my thanks also to those who've been involved in that project, because there has been an awful lot of work to engage that, as well as with the new toilet in the hall in a church here as well, which is, if you haven't seen it, please, and that's of your inclination, please do feel free to go and have a look. They've done a really good job of that as well, so it's nice to have that facility for convenience here in the church. Much better than trying to make your way up the stone steps of the vestry. It's much more convenient. So we give thanks for these things. We've had much to think about this morning with regards to things to do with our faith, things to do with changes within life, things to do with acting in a way that's Christ-like, and thinking about Christ himself in all that we do things. And so we conclude with the hymn 536, May the Mind of Christ Be in Us. 536, we stand to sing. As we go forth from this place, showing our faith in all the world, that we ourselves might pass on that faith which we ourselves received. May the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and abide upon you all and those whom you love, now and evermore.